Hi everyone, this is Real World Audio and we are continuing our active and passive crossover discussion. So I'm using Sublime Acoustics write-up that they have on an active crossover, and they give us really good reasons of describing how active crossovers work, how passive crossovers, and what are the advantages of actives over passives. I have found that they really emphasize the benefits that active crossovers have, and they don't really talk about any of their disadvantages. And it might give you the impression that they have no disadvantages, but yes, there are. And passive crossovers also have advantages, but they are not mentioned here. That's why I want to give a broader overview and the other half of the story. And we left off somewhere here. Let's just catch up right where we left off. Another major disadvantage with passive crossovers is efficiency. They waste a huge amount of power that your amplifier is providing. I really have to add here that the power wasting happens when you have very high order crossovers. The higher your order and the more EQing and leveling you use to level your driver's responses, the more efficiency you are wasting. And let's just go back to our drawing boards and let's clear this up from our previous video. So what am I talking about? So here on the left side we have our woofer, and here on the right side we have our tweeter. And to have a low pass network that is required for our woofer, we really need at least a coil, an inductor. And if we only have an inductor, so this is, let's say, the positive terminal of your amp, the negative terminal of your amp, if this is feeding your voice coil, this is the voice coil of the woofer, then we have a first order low pass crossover. So what this does is that if there are low frequency sounds coming, they are free to go through your coil, and they will reach the coil of your woofer and turn into motion. But when there are very high frequency sound coming, the inductance of this crossover coil will smear that, and it will basically be not allowed to pass through to your coil. And I would say at those frequencies where, if you look at the frequency range from low to high, it will just start to fall off like this. So a first order crossover per octave, it drops 6 dB in level. So it will create a nice and gentle crossover slope. And at this area where you start to have the drop off in the frequency, what happens is that the coil's inductance will make it seem as if the resistance is higher and higher at these frequencies. So there's your driver, let's say it's an 8 ohms driver, and when you add this inductor to it, at those frequencies which is below the crossover frequency, it behaves as an 8 ohm unit. But as we start to reach it, then the impedance will start to rise due to this coil, and actually as we go higher and higher, the impedance will rise to super high levels. So essentially your coil here, your choke, your inductor, is not wasting power of the amplifier, but it's preventing that power from reaching the coil. So it's like it's not soaking up the power from your amp, it's not taking anything, it's just refusing to use any power. However, when we add a capacitor here, now we are turning it into a second order crossover. And that's because we are using two different devices to create the filtering. And now we have a capacitor between the two poles. So now we are shorting out the signal. Now, this is the scenario when we are starting to waste power. And that's why if you have a crossover network for your loudspeakers, which is only first order, so you don't have that cap here, so only that for the woofer, or it would be a capacitor here for your tweeter, for the high-pass network, then that is not wasting any power from the amp. It's just preventing the lows from reaching the highs and the highs from reaching the lows. But once you go second order, now you are entering into that scenario that some of the power is getting wasted. And when you go higher order, so if we add like one more coil here and then an extra capacitor there, so we double this up, then we create a fourth order network. And as you see here, we are wasting even more, much more power. So that's why it's a good idea if you use passives to avoid high order crossovers, because then we are wasting, starting to waste some really serious amount of amplifier power. And when we look at our tweeters, often what happens is that it's easier to make a tweeter with much higher sensitivity than a woofer. So let's say I will just continue talking about the case of my speakers with the Altec 515 woofer and the 288 compression driver. And we have there a big discrepancy, about 10 dB efficiency between the two of them. So our compression driver is about 10 dB more efficient. Actually, let's say 12 dB is more accurate than the woofer. So it means that we have to burn off 12 dB to bring the level at the same for both of them. What does that mean? It means that basically almost 95% of the amplifier's power that drives the high frequencies will have to be wasted as heat. So there are some cases, so when we look at here, it says like up to 50% of power is lost as heat. There are cases like here that 95% of the power can be lost as heat. So yes, it is really a big consideration of passive crossovers that the loss of heat can be loss of power can be truly significant, and your amp is just, you know, running circles because it's just heating up a resistor instead of doing its job. But when we enter this situation that we are losing so much of the amplifier's power, it's not because of the inductor and capacitor, but also because a resistor is needed to drop the level. And that's why in many speakers, especially horn loudspeakers or speakers with compression drivers or very efficient tweeters, you always need a resistor to adjust the level of the tweeter. And that's where most of the power will be lost. But that's not just the case of the tweeter. Today, let me just first clear up the board again. So today, what manufacturers love to do is that here we have the woofer and we have the tweeter, and let's say that we have a second order crossover, and here we have the same thing, a second order high pass network. It works different. So for woofer, we have choke first and then cap, and for tweeter, cap first and then a coil. And what people do is they use networks to equalize the response between the two of them. So what people think is that people, the engineers who design the loudspeakers, the modern school of engineers, is to get the perfect response, we just take a driver, a woofer and a tweeter, which it has like a good value and would approximately work in our cabinet, but then we find out with computer simulations that there is a mismatch between them, and when we are trying to meet the frequency ranges of them, they are not don't mix up too well, and what they try to do is adjust the level of them. So for example, for the woofer, they are also adding a resistor to ground, and that will bring down a lively woofer if the tweeter doesn't have enough juice in it. And by also adding a parallel resistor, you can lower the impedance of the woofer and make it much easier for a tube amplifier to drive the woofer, so it will have a much more precise sound. But it will be at the cost that your amp will be burning up power as heat through the resistor instead of turning it into music. And you would say that, well, we just get a more powerful amp and then who cares? But actually, who cares is the resistor. Because whatever resistor you plug in here, it will contribute to the sound. And resistors, for the most part, contribute a very nasty aspect to the sound, which can be detailed as in this position, that it will just rob the life out of your loudspeaker. Yes, when you put that resistor in and you listen to it, you will have a more accurate sound. That is how you will hear it. But the brain has this strange thing built into it that when you listen to something, you always pick on at the improvements first. And it takes much longer for the negatives to sink in. And if there is like let's say a 30% improvement in some field, then we are really happy to notice that, but we don't notice right away, even if there are major cuts at certain other points. And especially because to be able to evaluate a change that you make to your crossover, you need to first let the crossover break in, and second, you need to listen to it with diverse music material. Because if you just plop it in and you have a favorite soundtrack that you use to calibrate your system or to design your product and test your product with, then you are basically shaping your crossover to match the colorations of that soundtrack, or maybe if you have five of them that you use, then to match the coloration of those five soundtracks. And that really can lead and will definitely lead every single engineer to a dead end. So here, this resistor will burn up amplifier power and rob life. And here, same thing, if you add the resistor for your high pass network to drop the tweeter's level, that will also take away a lot of the immediacy, a lot of the flesh and blood quality from your loudspeaker. So if you want to design a loudspeaker and a crossover that has a flesh and blood quality to it, that you can really feel that there are human beings creating a music, and it's not a Frankenstein sonata, or it's not cyborgs playing some acoustic fantasy illusion world, then adding those EQ networks and Zobel networks will totally just take you off course. And instead of getting back, let's just pause here and continue with the next video. So if you are still with us, if you are hanging in, if you are curious about active and passive networks, please continue, because we will carry on. And please like and subscribe so others can like and subscribe. Bye-bye.